Hello, wherever and whenever you are, and welcome back to the jungles of Chont. Welcome back to Phoenix Ubeki, and welcome to my birthday week. As we get to torment our players, and I have been promised at least 2 TPKs this week.
Ooh, whoa!
Who will it be? No, I promised myself that. Sorry. It just doesn't count that way. And who will it be?
All right, it's been nice knowing you guys.
Probably not this lot. I had to hopping over to Cobalt Fight Club. Right. I really had to keep clicking that goblin button before it became anything on the radar for you guys. more goblins, more.
more goblins.
Are we still doing mob mentality sort of things?
No, not even using the the swarm rules, the horde rules.
There is something very satisfying about just going full Dynasty Warriors, though.
Yeah,
just like
this would be a good option to you for that.
I'm kind of down.
To enjoy that because this is the first like martial class I think I've ever really played, and I have yet to enjoy the satisfaction of.
There will be.
I was about to say, don't jinx yourself. I've knocked on wood like six times.
Do I torment Colby with making the next big mob fight against Grungs? So it's all frogs.
No! We have to kill Grungs.
Colby loves
We're
frogs.
Near a Grung nest, too, I think.
Okay, so little catch up, everyone. Cheers, Phantom. And McClover and Hans, thank you for those birthday wishes. Yes, so a ripe old 46 this year.
Really?
Yes, indeed. Getting towards that half century. And you, dear friends here, have yourself a few gifts from our lovely spinny wheel of doom. So quick recap here. Oh, Phantom, thank you so much. Waku, Hugh, and Embra all have a wild magic surge waiting.
Five
as we're diving into initiative here.
Wild magic!
Hugh is Upsol Dexterity.
That is correct.
So remember that for your initiative roll in a moment. Embra is Upsol Strength.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
I didn't. I'm just picked the amount of wing beats, man. My jump score is insane.
What was it? A flying speed of 20 feet?
Yes. Sorry, you've given me a flight speed of 20 feet solely while I have Oops All Strength.
Yes.
And then as soon as it's gone,
it's like, oh, I can get used to this. Ah. At least you can glide when it stops working.
Well, that is true. Yeah. Thank God.
A very important addition. Waku has a +1 spellcasting focus.
Yes. All magic, as it will be called from now.
Which I think we can probably safely represent by you being encased in a dragon skeleton at the moment. So, dear friends, our adventurers have headed off towards the distant Arakokra Monastery of Kher Sabal, where they have been promised, if they enamor themselves of the locals, they will be able to conduct a special ritual that will give them the ability to fly without Upsol Strength, and a great deal more than 20 feet, and they will be able to make the journey safely across the jungle canopy of the Chiltern Peninsula all the way down southwest. Let me head over to the map here. Oh, and everyone has a crystal as well. Thank you. It was everyone but Hugh, but Phantom jumping in there with us. Dream Pies, thank you.
Yeah,
thank you so
there's
much.
Phantom.
He sees him. I zoomed right in here because this is where we are right now. But let's enjoy the full
day,
glory
Phantom.
Of this glorious map. Okay, so at the moment. Difference. They are over here. They are over here in Refuge Bay on their way to Kher Sabal around the northern rim of the fetid Nisi Wastes, the rancid remains of Rasnisi's ruinous reign himself of necromantic
fetid.
Undead. So I was trying to alliterate as much as possible. I ran out though.
I like that.
But they need to be all the way down here. Is that my, yes. Nestled here between the peaks of flame and the edge of the Cobalt Mountains, the Valley of Lost Honor lies the lost city of Ormu, as they have now discovered with the full extent of their travels and
we were
various
really close
cartographic things. Really close.
We were kind of close a couple of times, actually. What the hell?
You were at the other end of the Valley of Lost Honor for quite a while. Yeah, because you up here is where you enjoyed an alive dragon.
Enjoyed is a strong word.
I love that. Like Brackle didn't fall to specifically the dragon, like.
Right, it was the fire newts. Yeah, the fire newts will get you every time. Okay, but
shakes Brackle head sadly.
Was, let's reiterate there, just for reasons. Brackle was reconstructed, as they are a construct of the natural power of this vast, teeming peninsula here in Chult. They had been connected to the life force of the jungles, the creatures, and the leaves, which, in hindsight, Embra, is probably why you were very useful to Jilstein and your work in Port Nyanzaru, because of that certain affinity that you had with all of that. Then, having passed away and being brought back by your celestial patron, the vast being that is Sahra Umbazar, off in their jungle ziggurat, the Coatl spirit, a remnant of the divine power of this land, recreated Embra with the next element, fire, the volcanics of this place, a very active region. And it is that energy, that fire, that imbues this new incarnation of Embra. So, by that reckoning, you got two left. we got wind and water.
I'm not gonna lie, I may have plans for both already, just in case.
Nice. Well, let's bring you in on this. I mean, do you want to go the four, like, traditional four elements like that? In which case, you kind of skipped Earth. Or do you want to make aspects of Chult?
I like the idea of it being either aspects of Chult or like thing, because I have plans for water, very specifically.
Nice.
Mainly because, like, I don't know. The idea that we go from like Embra, who is like neutral, from like perky to like, I don't know. I'm not thinking edgelord, but I'm thinking like, I'm not gonna lie, a surfer accent has like popped through my head a couple of times.
Nice. Okay.
Specifically a Kulin Gadda surfer, which none of you have context for, but man, what a vibe.
Okay, thank you, McClover. It's very generous. Now, difference. You, as I said, were making your way from the beach of Refuge Bay around the top of the Nissi Wastes there towards Kersabal. And Hugh could not resist in his guiding abilities and responsibilities here to take you on a little side trip, a little sightseeing of somewhere that he'd always wanted to check out.
To your left.
Exactly. And you headed away from the Nissi Wastes a little. To the massive gaping hole in the jungle that is the cenote. Is it cenote or cenote?
Cenote, I think. Mm-hmm. It's a Spanish word, right?
Right. Yeah. Mm. So you headed up to the vast open space of the cenote of Needle's Bones. Needle being a fully grown adult green dragon that had been terrorizing this region until local Batiri goblin tribes tricked it, sealing it in its own lair, its swampy water lair, with vast nets that had also been prepared and filled with quippers, the D&D version of piranhas. And trapped and held down in the water, it was slowly devoured from its soft, scaly underside as these creatures and the goblins did their worst. But not without defending itself, the dragon decimated the Batiri goblins, almost wiping out the tribe. Our adventurers came upon the bones, bleached white by the sun coming in through the opening of the cenote above, and resting in the water here, still full of quippers and teeming with other amphibious life forms. Other amphibious? Amphibious life forms also. And they discovered some lost treasure. Remnants of the dragon's hoard still hidden away and, until now, unnoticed by other adventurers. But Waku has a magic eye patch and can discover the location of certain things like this. And using it, they discovered where the hidden the cache of treasure was. And rappelling down the side... Hey, thanks for the hydrate. Rappelling down the side, they made their way open, discovered it needs to be opened with acid. And managing to do so, they got themselves a bunch of nice treasure.
Shinies.
As...
Shinies!
As
it's gonna be
they,
shiny.
Yes, do remember, Waku is under the firm belief that if he amounts enough treasure, a hoard of his own, he will become godlike.
Dragon-like, but dragons are godlike, I guess. So.
Yes, indeed, Gunnus, thank you.
We're aiming too low. We need to go god. Man. Like, come on, man. That ego, that ego needs to be here.
There are steps involved. You can't go from five, one to
five
two.
Five-step process. You've already gone to two.
That sounds
you
like quitter talk.
You have prestigial wings.
Oh, sorry, one to seven.
There we go.
I'm a kobold. I do necromancy, not counting.
One, two, three rib cages.
So, as you emerged from the little hidey hole of treasure, what did you? How did you scare off the quippers? I forget.
With fear.
The fear ray.
Right? Oh yeah, the fear.
They have the wand of fear that's just like, nope.
Scared away all of the little beasties in the water, the frogs and quippers going teeming and leaping to safety as the terrifying Waku and their new wand of fear emerged. Skittering through the shallow water, Waku went over to marvel at the bones of the magnificent dragon needle as they are now, unfortunately, a dilapidated ruin of what they had once been. But he was surprised. As crude arrows rained down from above, he scuttled to cover, having taken a little bit of damage, and hid within the bones of the mighty dragon. And turning, Ember and Hugh still not have seen this, Waku beheld something terrifying. Tall, multi-limbed creatures with horns and tusks chittering and yelping from above as... mentioned, the Bateri goblins were almost wiped out, but not entirely. And there's probably going to be a loud stab of music in Sirenscape warning people's ears. Maybe. No, not this time. Okay. Sorry, a lot of their combat will start with like a just a really kick things up. This one started with a which is fair. Okay.
To be fair, also like that vibe.
Quite. Now, as I like this. It's like the battle music, but with like kind of like tribal drums over the back of it as well. Yep. I've heard this music without those tribal drums. That's great. Okay.
It's nice.
Sirenscape, working hard. Everyone, check out Sirenscape, all the cool stuff they've got. Lots and lots of cool things coming out. For Tomb of Annihilation, they're doing Tomb of Annihilation right now. So they're just managing to work out at the moment. Okay, so. Give me a shout if that's too loud. I think it's okay. Now, friends, you need to roll some initiative, but the quick kind of check here. Does anyone speak Goblin?
I speak Goblin.
I do not.
Okay, so Ember and Hugh, you hear this like angry these like battle cries, and you see Waku just scuttle for cover and like holding his side as you were hit by one of them, right, Waku?
Yeah, I was.
Yeah, a little bit wounded there. And Waku, you hear, trespassers in the Bateri territory, we shall destroy you. You have come under the ruin of Queen Crabstab.
Crabstab. I'm not gonna lie. The first time you said it, I heard grab dab, and now I'm that's all I can hear.
Okay. So, difference. It's you. I'm afraid there's no initiative tracker on this in Beyond Maps, but I will shout out who's next in the order. Please give me some of that good initiative roll. And shout it out.
Wow.
Yes. Yes, dear friend. Jones.
Oh, God. Oh, wait, no, that's a bad.
Yeah. It's going to be an 8 for me. Emperor.
Okay. It's a 15.
Thank you kindly. Embro is a 16 and a 15, you see?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, quick shout out. I'm getting a delivery of some textbooks today, this morning, so I'll have to jump out at some point. So.
Okay. I shall entertain the masses.
I'm sure you'll do it cleaner than the Phandelverum Beyond group did the other day.
What happened?
I don't know. I haven't watched the VOD yet, but I need to go and check it out. It's very suspicious. Hey, Roger.
Oh, no.
Okay. Oh, Phantom Gunner with a 14. okay.
Beat
so,
you, Phantom.
Our Queen Grabstab is first.
She's a little grabby, a little stabby.
Stabby for preference.
Okay.
I
figured she would prefer grab.
Oh, by the way, difference. I should bring you over here, shouldn't I?
I was going to say.
Bring
yourself. Oh, that's
nice. It's figuring itself out for me.
Yeah, sorry, it takes a second. This is quite a big image.
When I eventually get
okay.
there.
So, Hugh and Ember, you're actually still in the cubby hole, so you're kind of under that overhang where your
okay.
tokens
okay.
are.
That is a pretty map.
Isn't it cool? Grabbed off Reddit's maps.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So here is the cenote in all of its glory. For
my brain says
back
it
home.
Looks like Australia.
It does look a bit like
and
Australia.
And Tasmania is all weird.
I rotated it so it would be like more kind of portrait. And I was just like, oh!
Yep.
didn't
it's Australia!
how high up was the cliff face?
It was 30 feet, if memory serves. Let me double check for you. Needles bones.
That sounds right to me, but...
Yeah, we went down, because the thing was, like, in the almost in the water.
I know it's 90 feet across.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Searching, please hold.
Why did
yes, 30 feet down is the water.
Okay.
Why did the map maker include all of these ruins? I wonder. What were they thinking?
Well, it was the
if you'd come from if you'd come from the other side. Thanks, Lucetius.
There would be ruins.
Okay. just keep an eye out. We'll say that's algae rather than dry land in the cenote.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's all water. Do you like my little skeleton I added?
I like it.
It's me, Robojax. Turning 46 on the weekend. We have Grabstab front and center and four stacks on either side. Although Waku is seeing this in silhouette because it's against the sky above, and so you're not quite sure. Except they're speaking goblin, but you don't know what these creatures are. I think as we do embrace the Cobalt Press monsters here, I think you have heard terrifying rumors of the undead creature that is the Ogrepede.
Oh God!
Ogrepede.
No. That sounds so cool.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it was cool until the Human Centipede became a movie. And then it's gross.
I mean, fair, but like also, it's still kind
one,
of it's
this,
like
this one's better
because cool.
it's just one head. it's just many, many limbs.
Ogre centipede. Ogre
yeah,
centipede.
Okay, so we have our stacks here. We have little Waku hiding out in the ribcage there, and Queen Grabstab is going to shoot him.
That's not stabby at all.
Let's see.
That's neither grabby nor stabby. That's not fair.
Actually, no, it's a javelin, which is kind of stabby.
Okay. I accept that.
Those are stabby.
It will be with disadvantage, I think, because it's the range, the normal range is 30 feet. And it's 30 feet straight down. So, like, on the diagonal,
right.
Waku must be further.
And I'm hiding inside a rib cage.
That too. So you have a plus two to your AC.
It's true. Which is now 15 okay. as a result.
So, 15?
Yes.
Thank you. With the plus two. I have your ACs on this new combat tracker that we have.
That's right.
But thank you for telling me. Unfortunately, I can't roll with advantage. So that's already a 14, so never mind. A javelin. But she does have two attacks. So she reaches down and grabs another javelin from they like passing up.
She's also on a stack.
She's at the top. She's the tallest stack.
Oh. poor Grabby Stabby.
That's a natural one on the second.
It kind of tilts too far one way and she loses balance for a second.
Right. Embra is next with Waku on deck.
Alright. Next is in now.
Yes, please.
And I have no idea that this is happening, so well,
you see the javelins come down from above.
We heard them rattling
off the bones. Yeah, yes. You can hear in Sirenscape.
Alright, cool. With my quote-unquote beefed up self.
First things first.
TM.
Let's do a wild magic search.
It's a one! Because I remember that being like wild.
Which class? Because we have one.
Let's
every
see.
Class.
I am hulked out, so I think druid's more appropriate right now.
Nice. Okay, a natural one, yes. Robert's like to jump in on that.
A natural one in 100. That's so cool.
Ooh, okay, cool. For the next 8 hours, experience a wild magic surge every time you enter and leave Wild Shape.
Oh.
Does that include use of Wild Shape?
When you use it, and then when you reverse out of it.
So, summoning Kai uses a turn of Wild
Hell
Shape.
Yes.
So can I please roll again?
Right now? Okay, yes.
Are you kidding me? Kai needs to be out.
Excellent.
Kai's out. Sun's out. Guns out, I guess. 92 on the druid table, please.
92 is... Ooh. For the next 8 hours, also, each time you sit down, a comfortable tree stump springs up beneath you.
That is so
when you stand up.
That's so good. I suppose Kai will burst out. I'm allowed to summon them within 60 feet. I don't see what... If I poked my head out of that cave, do I see D, I guess? Because the others are behind me, so I don't think I'd see them.
Who are you looking for, sir?
Can I attack
you? I think from your angle, you just can't. Yeah.
I can't see D at all?
Let's see. Oh, across the way, yes. Yeah, fair enough, yeah.
Okay. I'd like to summon... I'd like to summon... I'd like to summon Kai by them, if I can.
Nice.
Because
we have a fire snake. That'll do for Kai. There he is.
Yay!
And tokens, you can control any token in this. This map isn't gridded, but if you use that ruler on the side, it is...
Yep.
That does work. And it is to scale.
Okay. I'm gonna figure out what button is the click to use the character.
So it's 60 feet away, 55 feet away.
So I will put Kai within 10 feet because within 10 feet it needs to make a dexterity save when they're summoned.
Nice.
DC 13.
DC 13 dexterity save for the goblin. Let's see here. Dex is the only thing they have. Thank God.
It's okay.
Meets it.
Damn it.
You see, Waka, you see this stack of goblins, and you see Ember from your point there. They nimbly leap out of the way, maintaining the stack. In the module here, they can swing on vines in the stack.
That's so good. So, conceptually, what happens is Ember essentially flicks a spark as it spirals out and it just lands on and kind of explodes almost florally into the form of Kai, and as it does it's just like a giant explosive mass appears. So that's my action. to have them out. With my bonus action, I just saw Waku get injured. Are they within 60 feet? Are you within 60 feet? Yes. Okay, cool. With my bonus action, I send with the other talon another spiraling snake forward, and I use one of my healing lights because I have no idea what you just got hit with. I just saw you get like for 6 points of healing.
Nice.
Thank you.
No worries.
Nicely done. Nicely done.
Thank you.
And I turned to you, and I'm like, I think, can I hear if they're above us?
You can hear cries from above you as well, yeah.
I turn to Hugh and I go, I believe they're above us.
Yeah, I think so.
And that's my turn.
Thank you. And Waku, over to you.
The wild magic, which I rolled last time, yes. Was like 96.
96 on the...
I'm a single class guy. I almost never multi-class.
Okay. Okay. For the next 10 minutes, your bonuses to deception and nature are opposite. Are they different?
Oh.
Nature minus one.
Deception.
Charisma
deception. Plus four.
Okay.
They're quite different.
Wise in the ways of nature.
You're so honest in this moment. You're just your purest self.
Yes.
In the presence of a dragon lord, he's being humble, apparently. Shall tell no lies.
I just want to see what hat's gonna happen when I do this. I've been thinking about this all week.
Yes.
I look down at the wand that I just received. I look back up at the towering figure, and I point my wand at it. I say, "Kneel!"
Okay. That is a wisdom saving throw?
Don't check. Mm-hmm. I think so.
It is.
Yes, Wiz 15.
Okay, and that's on the goblin at the bottom of the stack?
The goblin at the bottom of the stack.
Okay, my wisdom is a minus one.
There's two charges there.
That is a 12.
It kneels. It grovels.
Okay. Oh, can you see the rolls on the maps? Do they pop up for you?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Not for me.
Right, because it popped up for me. Let's just double checking.
Mm.
And yours pop up for me if you're rolling on the
sheet.
Maybe it's
the GM's a secret.
I guess so, yeah. Crimson Rockstar. Hello. Okay, so yes, Waku, you is this with the wand of fear?
It is with the wand of fear, yes.
Okay, and you command them to kneel. And could you roll me a d8?
Okay, what if only one of the people in the goblin stack kneel, and it's the legs?
Seven.
Okay. You, with this new understanding of your natural environment and everything that's going on around you, and the mighty beast, the skeleton of this dragon encasing you, you're at the center of its being, casting your magic from within. You reach up with the wand of fear, once owned by this selfsame dragon, and as you cast the spell, what does it look like? As you know, how does the magic manifest itself?
Well, the wand, of course, is being modified by Waku's magic. So a kind of, because I took this from a dragon, what eventually happens is the spirit, well, it looks like the spirit of the dead dragon shoots out at the goblin at the bottom of the stack and opens its mouth as it...
rolls in goblin right, Neil.
Roblins rolls, yes. As Waku roars through it in goblinoid, commanding it to kneel.
Nice.
And the magic, slams into the goblin.
Excellent, excellent. Okay, as it does so, you just see, it's like, its eyes go wide, and it says in goblinoid, "The Needle returns! And it just abases itself, like, faced full, like, head plant into the soft kind of moss and soil at the top of the cenote, where the vegetation and stuff spills over the rocky lip of the cenote. And as it does so, you feel this strange wild magic connection with the nature of this jungle peninsula, and you feel an essence of the dragon entering you, and poison from the dragon's ability starts to seep up out of the soil and moss surrounding the goblin with its head planted on the ground. It had 7 HP. It does not anymore. And it coughs and splutters. It's like, Needle's revenge out upon us! And dies. The stack needs to make a DC 10 dexterity save.
I hope it doesn't.
That's an 11.
Ten is...
I'm sorry.
Yeah, okay. 10 is not bad. 10 is not bad.
So the stack nimbly
train
leaps
battle stacks
off to the side. And the queen calls down, Batini, Needle, returns. We must put it in the ground once and for all. It is a mere shell of its former self. And she points at you, Waku, like thinking you are like the reincarnated, like, spirit of Needle.
I only need a shadow of my former power to defeat you, you pathetic goblins.
I think, honestly, at that point, Ember leans over to Hugh. Again, it's like, Waku's a what now? Fully convinced, by the way.
And, replacing Blades in the Dark and other game mechanics, I will fill in a section of a three-part clock.
The clocks! I love clocks. Clocks are so good.
Okay, now, that brings us to the goblet stacks. The first one, sorry, zoom out again, sorry folks. Okay, Hugh, Embra, you see coming into view just as just perfectly formed as a stack, just coming down the vines, just hand over hand, this the goblin stack A just comes down to the bottom there, and that uses all of their movements, so they then take the dash action to come dashing to about there. Okay, so they come dashing over to here, but they're not actually
okay
yet. Then descending like right next to them, there is another one that comes down right next to you here, and Hugh, they will actually attack you.
Okay,
the good news, only the goblin at the top can attack.
Okay, all right.
The bad news,
I have...
they just named it with the regular name. I am renaming it Stack Tactics.
Yes,
the Pack Tactics.
Yeah.
And they have
stack
advantage.
Tactics.
Yeah, naturally. Yeah.
Because they're all jabbing at you, but it's only counts as one hit.
Gotcha.
So, Embry, you just see Hugh like reaching up with his blade. It's just all of these goblins just down and down.
I'm straight up thinking the enemy, like the enemy, like battalions from the Wicked Witch of the West right now.
Right. That is a 17.
Ow.
Just hits.
That is just hitting.
Okay,
yeah.
So you take... Roll damage. How much damage? 6 slashing damage from their scimitars.
Okay, alright.
Stack attack. Yes, indeed. Okay. Let's see here. I think...
We have the Queen, C, and D left.
Yeah.
We think.
C will also, abseil down into the water and then charge at Embra.
Okay.
But they have to dash to do that, so they can't attack.
Right.
And D will attack our little fire snake buddy over there.
Mm-hmm.
Whee!
Phantom, how does that look on stream? Is it ridiculously small? If I have
little...
it, is it too small?
I think it's okay, but yeah, no, that's a bit better.
Yeah,
where you have
okay?
it right
can
now.
Can you make out who's who?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If anyone's watching on mobile, how does that look?
I think that's probably the safest.
My view is not much bigger than a smartphone screen. I can see you too. So yeah, just give me a shout, chat. I'll zoom in further and then pan around if we need to.
Enhance.
Right. Okay. So I attack you, Embra. Well, not you, but your friend.
Me.
With advantage.
Attack. With advantage? Yeah, wait for
stack tactics.
Oh. So that includes all of like the goblins within.
There are four goblins in each of these stacks, and four underneath Grub's tab, but now there are three.
That makes more sense.
Cheers, Robojax.
Okay.
Okay, so that is a dirty 20, I'm afraid, against our sneak friends.
Our little bubby.
which is gonna be 8 damage.
Oh, they're alive!
Cough splitter. Okay.
I'd like to think that when they cut through, it's like, what is it? They cut through, and like, because flying snake, like some of like the, it's sort of almost hairs, sort of like, what is it? Burning parchment.
The way it kind of burns away. Love it. Sorry. My mouth isn't working, but I know exactly what you mean. Hugh, over to you, let's see,
what's the queen gonna do?
Queen's already acted.
She has, but the goblins haven't.
Actually, sorry, can I get you to reroll that attack? Because it was summoned, but it didn't actually do on anything, and it can only take the dodge action on its turn when it's initially summoned, unless I do it, so that would have been at disadvantage.
Which would have made it a flat roll instead. Yeah.
Yes, it had apologies.
No, it's fine.
I just reread the thing and I was like, whoops. Is
Make
it still
up the
dead?
Tokens, but not the names on mobile. We don't need the names, that's fine. Okay.
Seem to appreciate Emma City art.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we've got the slideshow going on the screen, that's all good. Can't wait to see our new friend who's going to be joining us.
Mm-hmm.
New art for that. I just did some voiceover work for Emma, and I was promised a piece of art in payment for that. So I'm going to use that right away. Okay.
Yes.
And good news, Emma has said she is up for drawing for Humble Folk. She's like, I can do
Humble Folk. Oh, nice!
Yes.
Okay, so. That is only going to be a 13.
Insufficient. They live. Just.
Okay.
That's what I use. I'm just like, that was insufficient. Do better.
Now, I think... Yeah, I do think Grabstab's stack would also come down. But they...
I know. Directly on top of me.
It's funny. It's funny because they move... because the goblins move and Grabstab attacks. So... Mm-hmm. Their turn is kind of split across the two of them. So I'm going to put them just like out here because you're not actually sticking out there, Ember. So
okay.
They are right in front of you.
Hello.
But they can't, on their turn, they can only move, so they don't get an attack this time.
Okay.
Which brings us to you.
All right. I think I have a wild magic surge as well.
Yes, indeed.
All right.
Yeah, fighter magic surge.
Rolling the D100. A 94.
Everyone, like, it's a lot, lots of high numbers. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Or a 1.
Okay. I had a 1.
Just a flavorful thing here. For the next hour, your dominant hand switches sides. So, Ember, you see Hugh, like, faced with this battle stack and these new tactics he has to deal with. He seems to have an idea of his own. He goes, ha! And flings his sword across the other hand.
That's so wonderfully silly.
Oh my god.
I kind of adore that.
I do hope at some point there is an opportunity for you to shake someone's hand and it's just awkwardness ensues. What? Okay.
It's a great sword. It's like two-handed, so you like...
So you just change your grip.
Yeah.
Change.
Okay, that's right. Yeah.
The main hand, yeah.
Okay. So...
You know what? sorry, just for shits and giggles, the things that I know in this head of mine, and because it's my birthday, I'm going to inflict disadvantage on your first turn as you come to terms with being other-handed.
Okay, all right.
For my birthday, I'm gonna cause suffering.
Can I?
I'm just gonna put in their names how many goblins are in each stack.
Am I able to get the queen? I need to move a little bit.
It would be an attack of opportunity.
Well then, you know what? We're just gonna swing at B.
Don't worry about it too much.
Okay.
I have a swing.
I'm in a ribcage. Look at me, all confident.
I am in a ribcage, and I have what they call a great idea. So.
I do like those. A thing's called those.
There was a Cayley band. If you know what Cayley is, it's like a Celtic dance party. Scottish Irish.
Yep.
Music. There was a Cayley band called Baldrick's Cunning Plan in my home area. If you're familiar with Blackadder.
Love it.
Love it.
All right, rolling to hit with great sword.
Okie doke.
Okay.
Is it a great sword? Or is it an okay sword?
It's fine.
Not in this second, it's not.
It's what they call an sword.
The first attack is a 10.
There's not enough, I'm afraid.
Don't think it's going to do it.
Okay, yeah, just a flurry of scimitars meets your sword on several levels. multi-parry. All of them, now that you can see them, you could. I should show the stacks over them back home. They all have these incredible masks that the Batyria are very famous for. And Hugh.
Oh, I saw that in the art.
You know that if you grab some of these masks, they would go very well to collectors back in Port Nyanzara. They're based on like jungle creatures, dinosaurs, and actually you notice these ones because of the proximity to the Missy Wastes. There are some that are stylized undead as well.
Ooh.
And we say with like with Waku being like fashion.
I'm gonna use
I'm
my
fabulous.
Bonus action
yeah.
to
little smidgen of bone is pathetic in comparison.
There's only one thing we can do with this insult.
Steal.
I'm gonna manifest my echo bonus action. It's gonna go right here.
Warning. The ping is terrifying.
The demonic ping. I'm going to make my second attack. Is the second attack also a disadvantage? Or
right, so. Just this first time.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
And by the way, I'm gonna put. If you can keep borders off your tokens. I'm going to put borders for effects and things. So this one is the echo.
Okay. Understood.
Ooh.
So yeah, I'm using a red border for unconscious. So if someone's unconscious, I've got a red border.
Gotcha. Okay.
I suppose we could do bloodied and glass legs with that as well. We could do yellow and red.
Let's
see if there's a different color I can use for unconscious.
15 for the second attack.
15, okay.
Yep, and that's on stack B.
That just hits.
Okay, alright.
Which goblin are you attacking?
We're gonna swing at the bottom.
Rude.
Yeah.
Okay, how much damage is that?
Okay, so that's 5 plus 6, 11. I rolled a 1. So I'm gonna use my Great Weapon Fighter to reroll that 1. It is also a 1. Okay, so 12.
That's still enough.
Your
greatsword just even slightly awkwardly with the switching of hands just cuts through the bottom goblin, just cleaves them in half, and the stack has to make a dexterity save. Oh, okay, that's a 13. They're okay.
So okay, all right.
The stack just goes next to the space. The D&D 3D dice messes with Sirenscape a bit. I'm gonna roll this.
Okay.
It's right on the edge of my computer crapping out.
Undesirable.
I'm going to use one of my Unleash Incarnations. Lets me make an additional attack from the Echo's position. So I'm going to swing at the grab stab stack with my Echo.
Three goblins underneath, because that one was poisoned.
Also disadvantage with the Echo, so we'll roll that.
No, that would be
no.
No, because the Echo isn't. It's just you.
Well, I got a 19.
Nice.
So
are you going for the bottom goblin we'll again, or are you going for the queen?
We'll go for the queen this time. Yeah, we'll go for the queen this time. It's going to be 12.
12 damage. Okay. She is a tougher one.
Sure. Natural.
Let me switch up the music a little bit. Something suitably epic for our needs here. Okay.
There it is. There it is. Classic.
And she is bloodied by that.
Okay, all right.
Okay. And let's go to...
That's my turn. I'm not going to move.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
That brings us to grab step. She attacks. She has two attacks.
Okay.
Okay, and I quote, multi-attack. The Goblin Queen makes two attacks with their scimitar. The second attack has disadvantage.
Oh, okay.
But she's in the stack, so it's advantage
goes to
the first
advantage.
Time, straight roll the second time. So, there you go.
So if we cripple the stack.
Right. Okay, there's going to be a 19.
Ooh. Who's she hitting?
You.
Oh, okay. That's going to hit.
Echo. Doesn't the Echo only have one HP?
1 HP, yeah. So Echo's gone.
Gone, Echo. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
I'll just bring it over here just in case it reappears later.
Okay, it will.
The power of Grayskull.
And then second attack, which is a regular attack against Embra. That is going to be only a 9.
Can I sentinel that?
Actually, sorry, can I just do something to your attack from before, Q? Sorry.
Sure, yeah.
She has a reaction called redirect attack. And someone attacks the queen, she can swap places with a different goblin, so she just drops down in the stack and the goblin is hoisted up above her and the sword just hits the goblin instead.
swats it clean off the stack.
Yeah, so it is.
Okay.
It's a Daruma.
It's not the, yeah, right?
It's that little stack
that
thing
with the
little
yeah.
mallet.
Yeah. And actually I cannot sentinel because the queen is not within 5 feet of me.
For example.
So, yeah.
Okay, so she's only on two goblins now.
Okay.
but
she has full health.
Significantly shorter than all the other stacks, though. That's got to be embarrassing.
Right.
I would not be surprised if she ushers another goblin over to her stack.
Just like, oi, come here. I must be taller than everyone else.
Ember, your turn with Waku on deck.
Okay. Why is everyone always so close? frustrating. Okay.
Is that you, Drow? Did you change your name, Drow? I don't know.
Let's see. What do I got? So, since everyone is so close to me. Okay, so it is each creature of my choice. Awesome. Can I please have a constitution saving throw from each of the from grab stab stack and C4.
Yes, indeed. I just because need to reacquaint myself. One set of attributes is the top goblin, and one set of attributes is the bottom goblin.
Oh god.
Okay. So this is coming from the base level, so if you want to treat it like that, I'm not sure how you would like to. But I'm going to use Word of Radiance.
Yeah.
Okay,
the goblin at the top makes intelligence, wisdom, and charisma checks and saving throws. The goblin at the bottom makes strength, dexterity, and constitution.
Okay. Cool. I love that there's specific rules for that.
That's so funny.
So it's just a regular goblin. So it's actually better for you, probably. Because the queen's probably stronger.
Mm.
So as we've already described Ember multiple times, is when they start to get a little bit weird, their mouth sort of leaks out ash and, like, fiery spark.
Nice.
The way that Word of Radiance works for them is, like, they utter Saha and Laz's name, is that almost like a snake tongue, like, and the jaw kind of widening out, two fangs sort of appear, and, like, the hiss that emits comes out as this really strong and powerful just spray of light, for lack of a better word, as Word of Radiance is called, and Ember calls upon the fires of Chult, essentially.
Nice, yeah. Okay.
So if the DC for that one, sorry, I think
that delivery has arrived, so please talk amongst yourselves for a second.
All right, so as that spray happens, if they manage to beat a DC 13, which is not that good, but you know, we're working on it. When we level up, we'll work on it even more, I say with crying. there'll be that sort of, I don't know, I suppose like Hugh is unaffected by this because it says I can pick. So I suppose how does Hugh like not get hit? In your like what do you think, how does he not get hit by like the spray of light?
I would think that maybe he uses like the flat of the greatsword to like, I don't know, like kind of like a welder's helmet, like he just holds it from his face.
What is it? You enhance the beam of light by like, ah, yes, mirrors.
Yeah. Using the shiny metal of the greatsword to reflect and amplify the light.
Now, while the DM is away, quick, everyone, I like write a million compliments to Phoenix in chat for his birthday.
Ah.
Wow, you're so kind.
Oh, because incredible. Like, we give him insults, it's what he wants.
Oh yeah.
You never give them what they want. That's how you make them suffer.
He is truly. I've had three DMs in my entire life, and he's far and away the best, the most prepared, the most structured, the most willing to entertain your shit, but. He's still daddy, so, you know.
I return.
That was the perfect timing. Yeah. Enjoy the VOD.
That was good, yeah.
Equally suspicious to the Phandelverum below return. Okay, while the DM is away, Phantom. Tell me, Phantom, grass, come on, grass up. What did they do?
No.
Xelia, thank you.
Phantom, like I said, you have excellent miniature painting skills. I'm quite envious.
Yes, yeah, in the arts in the Discord. Everyone, jump in the Discord, check out Phantom's cool miniature painting.
Ooh.
Already in there. Okay, now, difference. So that was Word of Radiance, right?
Yep, DC 13 save.
DC 13...
I need to find a way to up this DC, like my spell save DC.
Now, actually, I think this stack works a little different. Are you specifically targeting the queen?
I am. So I'm specifically targeting, I suppose, the stack because it emits from me in an area of 15 feet, is the thing.
Oh, okay.
And I get to choose enemies get hit by it.
Okay.
Each creature of your choice within range must succeed on a constitution saving throw. So the whole thing.
So you're getting the three stacks?
Yeah, well, whatever's within 15 feet, so right. I think I can only hit the... Oh, no, I can hit B3.
A burning radiance erupts from you, each creature of your choice within range. So I think you can choose to hit the three stacks and the queen, because we're kind of dealing with her differently.
Nice.
Yes, please.
So this is 2d6 radiance.
Yes, the con save is 13. It'll be 8 points of radiant.
And it's 8 radiant? Okay, thank you. So
and we've decided that the way Hugh's avoiding it is that he's using his sword as like a mirror to beam it into the further thing's eyes.
Nice. Okay, so like, goblins, stack B gets a natural one. then stack C gets a natural 20. Sorry.
No in between.
Let me do emotes. Let me do emotes. I just need to mark that. Interesting.
Mark the occasion.
The spectrum.
Okay. And then the stack under grab stab is a 5. And then grab stab her good self is a natural 1.
Wow.
Wait, 2 natural ones?
Yep.
That's incredible.
At least it wasn't an advantage or disadvantage roll, because that would be a wild magic surge. okay. Yeah, thanks, Drew. Okay. So, 2 seconds, please. And that was 8 damage, you said, right?
8 damage total, yep. Okay. For each... everyone that's failed.
Yeah.
Okay,
so this one is only now 2 goblins high. And this one is down to 3. And then Grabstab is left on her own because the stack loses a goblin. And
yep.
She uses her reaction again to shove the other goblin into the other one.
What if it lands on the water? Hang on a second. You, get over here.
So she's all alone now. I don't know, right?
So that's my action.
I just need to roll and see if the 2 regular stacks.
Sorry, I didn't realize how many more.
No, just to see if they fall down. Dex save, only DC 10. Natural 20 and...
2 natural 20s and 2 ones? What?
The balance must be maintained. And a 15. Okay.
Okay.
So, they do not fall prone.
Awesome. Bonus action. Command Kai to honestly roast. Kai up on that top ridge is dealing with that last one.
Yeah.
They are going to... Where did the actual wording of this go? So they're going to use, specifically for them, they're going to use the fiery teleportation action, because they're immediately next after me. To get back 15 feet, but again, that explosive fiery burst. So it's that DC 13.
DC 13, what's it?
Yep. Dex.
Okay, Dex is the bottom goblin. That is only a 9.
Woo! In that case, they take it. They take a whopping 5 plus. They take a whopping 8 damage.
That's for a goblin. That's enough. So one of them is consumed.
As that goblin is consumed, and Kai is. If I could move Kai, give me Kai. It's not letting me move him.
If you have something tool selected, it won't work.
There it is. As Kai moves back roughly 15 feet, so I'm gonna say they go over to here. So they can spit more heat later.
Spitting straight fire.
And that's my move.
I get attack of opportunity, right?
And no, because it's a teleportation. They sort of like explode out, And gotcha. Usually they can carry people, but because they're by themselves, they explode out, move there, and that's where they're at.
No hit. Okay. So yeah, they again, I got 21 on the dex save, so that these are very dexterous stacks.
It's okay.
And that one just lands, but it is now just 3 goblins tall. Okay. The great and powerful necromancer Waku.
It is I, the great and powerful necromancer Waku.
What?
He who casts shatter on the middle of the a goblin.
A? Okay.
I don't know how close A and B are, but it is a good chance they could get caught because 10-foot radius.
Mm. If you want to make it so, you could. Yeah.
Sure.
You can measure. You can use a measure tool if you want to check it out.
Yeah, I mean, I just put it in the center.
Okay.
They'll get caught as well.
And so DC, what save?
Con 16 because of my great and powerful magic of the rolling.
Okay. The that is a 9 and a 2 on the dice. So there's just a and so I'm gonna you know what? It's an area of effect spell like that should affect everyone.
Yes.
I think so. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to roll 6 saves. So that's two failures.
Sorry, what was this?
John.
Yeah,
you don't have to roll anything. The damage is currently 21.
Okay.
they're all dead.
Can you also roll a D8?
Yeah. It's an 8.
An 8?
It's an 8, yeah.
Okay, so 29 even halved would be over 7.
Yeah.
What does your shatter normally look like?
It normally...
It's just
nice,
or...?
Just... I mean, it's... I imagine it's like a spectral skull appears where I center it,
yeah.
And then just starts to laugh and explodes.
Nice.
Bernie beats.
Okay, so
magic.
Yeah, so a skull just explodes, and this time explodes in a noxious, poisonous green cloud.
Ooh.
Does that poison damage as well, and there is a and all of the water in the cenote ripples and some of the bones shift and some dust falls down from Needle's skeleton. Waku.
Oh boy.
And
you need to get out of here.
These stacks are gone.
Our god.
Wow.
Which brings us to the sex turn. A and B.
We have invoked the wrath of Needle.
C.
Vengeance will be mine.
C. C just kind of spin around Embra, like, and grab stab bolts onto the top.
I called that one.
Use the restroom. I'll be right back.
Nice. Mm-hmm. So put 3 gobos under grab stuff again.
Gobos.
And the other ones. Kai, where is Kai, like, vertically?
Kai is about. So how tall is the the thing's about 30 feet, right?
Yeah.
Up. So Kai is just 15 and then 30 up.
Gotcha. So is it the jungle level?
Jungle level. If somebody were to throw, say, a javelin, they'd be able to, that would be within range for sure.
But are they still next to the edge, like they look on the map?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the stack will run over to them so they get the advantage, because they wouldn't get the advantage on the javelin.
Yeah.
So So the stack just like precariously, you know, like a toddler is like just like running along the an edge that they shouldn't be on, comes running over to the edge where Kai is, not having learned the lesson at all, go for that attack with the advantage.
Okay.
That is going to be 13.
13. One second. It is. Where'd you go? That hits.
Yes. Hey.
Yeah.
Okay. So that is going to be 8 slashing damage.
We're back to that original. It got owied.
It's not. But it's still there.
It is still there because that first hit did not count.
So yeah, the goblins come rushing over and attack there, and don't have any bonus actions. Nope. Okay, that's them, which brings us to Hugh.
All right.
Hugh, the Echo Knight fighter.
One thing I don't like about this. The tracking order for the D&D Beyond encounter tracker is you can't remove dead things from the initiative order, so you're just stuck with them in there. But I guess that is because, you know, things can be brought back.
I mean, it makes sense.
They can.
Nods emphatically.
I'm very familiar with this concept. In fact, there are some zombies. Somewhere here.
True, that's true.
I was a little bit worried about them, so I put them back in the canopy, and the goblins must have just kind of not seen them. Yeah. That's fine.
I think they're used to avoiding like undead in this area because of the problems that involves. If they don't have to. Okay, so Hugh, what you up to?
Okay, so I am going to. How far down are we exactly?
30 feet.
We're all the way down at the bottom.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. All right. I am going to I'm going to climb up halfway. So 15 feet. I'm going to use my bonus action to manifest my echo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, right here. Demon Pingo.
You can use the little tail thing. This is the other option in that menu.
Oh, the point. Oh, that's cool.
That's a bit more chill.
Okay. Yeah.
And if you move it around, it has a tail.
Oh. Okay. Look at that.
So that's much more chill.
Yeah. Much.
Okay.
So,
there's gonna be an attack of opportunity from that climb.
Is it?
Oh no, because you were away, weren't you? Sorry, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think because I she wasn't within reach of my attack.
Yeah, so I'm gonna put you on stone here.
Okay. Okay, so I'm gonna climb up about halfway. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna summon the echo where, you know, 15 feet down right here.
Gotcha.
Hey,
and then I am going to. Oh, hey. I'm going to go ahead and make my two attacks on the queen.
Okay. We're fighting goblin battle stacks.
First attack 16.
16 against the.
The queen. The queen, gotcha. Yes.
Misses, I'm afraid.
Oh, okay. All right. I really want to get one good hit in at least, so I'm gonna use the crystal on my next one.
Go for it.
Okay.
Can I make a tactical suggestion?
Certainly.
She has an ability to shift to a different.
Oh, you know what? I did see that.
Oh, she's already used her reaction. Oh, okay. Then go ahead.
Okay.
Never mind my
reset until after Hugh's turn.
We're swanging. An 18 this time.
That'll do it.
Okay. All right. Very close. Very good. 15 on that one.
15 damage?
Yep.
Okay.
She is bloodied.
Okay. I'm going to use one more of my Unleash Incarnation.
Can you do it more than once on a turn?
Let's see. You can heighten your Echo's Fury. Whenever you take the attack action, you can make one additional melee attack from the Echo's position.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, all right. So just a straight attack there. 19.
But you've already made two attacks, right?
Right. So with my second attack, I can make an additional melee attack from the Echo's position.
And all of your own attacks can go through the Echo?
Yes. So, let's see. You can... Blah, blah, blah. When you take the attack action, any attack you make can originate from yours or the Echo's space.
Okay.
You make this choice with each attack.
One less straight attack, then.
Yep. So that was a 19 to hit with 5 and a 2. I think I can reroll that 2. Yeah. Great weapon fighting. I'm going to reroll the 2. So 5 plus 6 is 11 plus another 6 is 17 damage.
Wow. Okay. Looking very, very bad.
Okay.
Nice. Okay. Anything else on your turn?
No. Movement, bonus action. I'm good.
Okay. In what will probably be her last action, Ember, you're on deck. The queen goes for just going for the echo again. Doesn't understand what's happening here. Makes those scimitar attacks.
Mm-hmm.
First one. It's a 21.
Okay, yeah, that's gonna hit.
Okay, so
Echo poofs.
Yeah, it's gone.
I don't understand why this thing won't die.
Right. And second attack is a 15 on you, Emperor.
Yep. You know what? Reaction spiny shield.
Okay. What's that do?
When they hit me, so I have the I blink away from my thing for 2 seconds. So yeah. I have the Armor of Shadows. So at will I can cast Spiny Shield is a spell that's a reaction that when they hit it,
2d4.
It's 2d4, so okay. It reduces the amount of damage, but they take that damage.
Yes. Plus
like
it's 2.
D4.
And you get plus. Oh no,
plus 2
to
by
AC.
Ranged
attack.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's ranged attacks, yeah. Okay. So roll the 2d4, please.
That's minus 6.
Six.
Yeah.
Okay.
I got lucky. I rolled a 4.
Nice. So the damage is 5. So that's
all damage reduced.
Is reduced
5 to the enemy.
And 5. and again, because she gets her reactions back at the start of her turn.
Yeah.
She's gonna thrust a minion in the way.
Just like they. What is it? Instead of it, like the reflavorer is like she's hitting it with the minion.
Absolutely.
Alright,
okay.
That gets cast.
So she sees you start to cast the spell, and she's like, and just like shoves one of the minions in the way, just like swooping around the back, and they get impaled on the spikes.
With their little feather spike wings.
Yeah. I think this is going to be easier for me to remember if I do this.
Goodbye forever.
She's
almost all alone.
There. Okay, there we go. But that one of them is very badly damaged there. Very badly wounded. And that brings us to Wagyu. Oh no, that was your reaction.
I was going to say it wasn't the reaction.
I was like, it's because Ember was doing things. Emery, your turn.
Yep. Alright, for my turn, It's that word of radiance again. Oh, actually, is it word of radiance? Hang on, let me just. Do I have range? Yes. Yes? Hang on. Is this touch? No, most of my stuff is range, yeah. Word of Radiance, can I have that dexterity saving throw, please?
It's everyone, right?
It's everyone within 15 feet, so every enemy within 15 feet, so that entire stack.
It's only everyone within 5 feet.
Oh, sorry, within 5 feet, my bad.
Yeah, yeah. And we'll say it's the same one that's got spined damage.
Yep.
So dexterity saving throw?
Yes, please. 13. Not high.
Okay. Dexterity plus 2. That is a 14. Just.
Damn. All right.
Dang it.
That's fine.
The stack kind of is like a snake moving.
Yeah, what is it? Because it's the beam of light, they all put on sunglasses at the same time and pull them back down. They've seen it happen before.
Like the mice in the first, really simple Wallace and Gromit cartoon. You know, when the rocket takes off.
Yeah.
Oh man.
Yes. Bonus action, instruct Kai to, instruct Kai to do the same thing as described previously. Okay, so Kai is going to do that. I need that DC 13 dexterity saving throw from you.
Okay, how far do they bump away?
15 feet, but they have their movement still, so that I'm going to bring them over toward me.
Okay, dexterity saving throw. It's going to be that one.
Sweet. Yeah, right. Can you please take a nice juicy 7 fire damage?
Oh, just enough to remove a little bit of verticalness.
No, okay. Not the height.
The height. And
as they swing down.
Still dexterous. They're okay.
Still dexterous. They're going to move. They have 60 feet. I'm going to put them. I'm going to put them over here, actually.
Yep.
So close enough to be like swings into view. Okay, a grab step, but whoosh, not.
Yeah, comes through me down like, yep. like a vengeful phoenix.
Da-na!
Okay.
Batman noises.
Wacky, over to you.
Alright. So we're gonna.
Don't worry, everyone, it's just.
Is grab step stacked down to 2?
No.
Okay. We're going to step out. Not step out, we're gonna kind of lean out. And we're going to Circlet of Blasting.
Grab some stack.
Yep. I'll target one scorching ray out of the 3 at each individual member of the stack.
Is that a save or a roll to hit?
I believe it is a roll to hit. Let me double check. I was just
ray.
It is a ray, so it's rays are usually right. Attacks. Yep, it's ranged spell attack.
Okay, go for it. 3 ranged spell attacks, please.
Bottom is going to be a hit. It's a 23.
Nice.
Middle. Mm-hmm. It's going to be an 18.
Okay.
The grabby stabby. It's going to be a 15.
Well, there's 3 goblins underneath her.
Oh, 3 it's goblins
her, yes,
under...
her plus 3, yeah.
Well, we're going to get all 3 of the mini goblins then.
Okay. What's the damage?
2d6. 1 for my extra magical abilities. Is a 9.
Okay.
Well, I guess I have to roll them all separately, don't I?
That's fine. And a d8, please.
And a d8, please. That's a 2.
Okay. So for a total of 11 against their 7 HP. Again, you know, as opposed to the normal looking scorching gray, these ones are green flame as they are imbued with the poison of needles and their lust for revenge. And he just goes across and just hits as they all erupt from your outstretched wand. And
oh, well, the bone mask that Waku wears, there's a small gem in the middle of it. It shoots out.
Nice. And
you're Sparky Sparky Boom Boom Man.
Let's do this here. Okay. As you position yourself and you go to charge up the circlet on your forehead, ready to blast out this divine retribution against the killers of such a majestic beast. Again, there's another and a shockwave goes through the water from the center of the cenote there, and this time not only dust comes down off the bones, they actually shift and animate. And they turn ponderously round, and the dragon's skull opens up its massive jaws, and your scorching rays go flying out of the dragon's mouth like a breath attack, hitting the three goblins underneath the queen. She, I'm not even going to roll the dex save, she's sent sprawling into the muck below, and she just grovels in the algae filled water, and she looks over at you in the mouth of the dragon's skull, and she's like, it's true, it is Needle reborn. You have our fealty. We repent. We wronged you, almighty dragon. Please spare us pitiful few. And she snarls, you lot, you. And the goblins up, there's two goblins left up in that last stack. Up on the top, on the top of the cenote, and both of them, they de-stack, and they both just like foreheads to the rock, like at the edge of the cenote. He's like, please, great reincarnation of Needle, join us, come to our village that we may celebrate you in earnest. How does Akawaku respond?
Waku looks around at the bones of Needle, and for a moment he tries to think as a green dragon would. And he stands as tall. He clambers on top of... Well, first he clambers on top of the skull of Needle, and he looks down and he says, Needle wants not for fealty, Needle wants vengeance! And he casts Shatter on them.
And Shatter on the queen?
Yes. And okay. And the assembled goblins.
Well, there's only the queen there.
Oh, I thought they came down. Sorry. No, we'll Eldritch Blast the queen then.
Okay. Hey, Lissy, just thanks for inspiration for Hugh.
Nice.
Just the Shatter goes off again in that green cloud, and just with a Ember and Hugh, you just see the Viteri Goblin Queen just explode in front of you as they are blown to pieces and destroyed.
Wow.
Good time with the music too.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, let us head back to the swamp. Yeah. The sounds of the jungle, and the frogs, and everything slowly come in back around, filling your senses once more as this battle subsides. Mm-hmm. Whack. There is a rumbling and crunching sound. And the bones of Needle start to fall apart and disintegrate into pieces, crashing into the water and splashing all around you. But there is a small wisp of green energy that spirals around, and Ember and Hugh, looking through, as you're looking directly at the exploding queen, you see in the frame of Viscera, Waku, outstretched hand, and this green mote of smoke-like energy goes in through his nostrils. And Waku, as you have claimed this dragon's hoard and some of its powers, you take your next step on your journey to becoming a full dragon, and you have unlocked the first abilities of the Way of the Ascendant Dragon Monk.
Whoa!
What?
Which means, let's look here.
Not gonna lie, Ember literally leans over. It's like, is that a good thing?
Who knows?
You can look up the subclass in your free time there. The two first abilities are Draconic Disciple and Breath of the Dragon.
Wow.
So, get a breath weapon? Yes.
Draconic Disciple, you channel draconic power to magnify your presence and imbue your unarmed strikes with the essence of a dragon's breath. If you fail an intimidation or persuasion check, you can use your reaction to reroll. As you tap into the mighty presence of the dragon you will someday be. If it turns the failure into a success, you can't use it again until a long rest. So if it doesn't work, you do get to try again.
Yay.
Okay.
When you damage a target with an unarmed strike, you can change the damage type to poison.
Ooh.
You already speak Draconic, right?
I do.
Yeah. You would have gained the ability to do that as well, but you are already along the path. And then the Breath of the Dragon. You can just channel destructive waves of energy like those created by the dragons you wish to become. When you take the attack action on your turn, including spell attacks, you can replace one of them with an exhalation of draconic energy in a 20-foot cone of poison.
That's pretty sweet.
There is a dexterity saving throw, which will be against your spell save, not your key save, because you don't have one. And they will take a damage. It says two rolls of your martial arts die.
So d4 at level 1.
Let's say, we'll look up how the martial arts die proceeds. It's d4, but we're level 5, so it's a d6 at
level. We're level 5. Yeah.
So you could do a d6 in a cone. So everything in the cone.
Okay.
That's
good. As a warlock, I love it.
Right?
Yeah.
When I was a dragonborn and I had like stuff, I wasn't worried about conserving my resources so much because I could always resort to hit him with stick.
Right.
I was like, I never use my breath weapon. But as Waku.
Right. If we hit 11th level, that will become 3 rolls of that die. And the die will increase, you know, as it comes up. Yeah, to use the giant dragonfly, whatever that was. And,
I love it.
You can use the number. You can breathe. Bulk use the breath weapon stage. Proficiency bonus times per long rest.
Okay.
Enjoy.
Funny.
We can homebrew some feats to represent those. It's probably the best way. That's one thing. The one thing I will miss about Roll20 is you can just grab a feature from any class and subclass and just drag it onto your character sheet.
Yeah.
That is very cool. Whereas, yeah, D&D Beyond doesn't have that adaptability. Okay. And just as a little... No, I'll save that for when. Don't look ahead in the monk subclass there, Waku.
So no, not, look, we'll not
save,
looking.
Save the others for as excite because you're not studying this. You're being gifted with this from the natural environment.
Waku had managed to take over the young red dragon's horde. Similar stuff.
Indeed.
Ooh.
Well, actually. It would have started the process. He's going to get the things at level, regardless. Mm. It's like basically it's okay. Like it's like a weapon, you know, like a weapon that evolves with you, like a magical item that evolves with you.
Yeah. Nice.
I do recommend this to any DMs out there. I really like using a subclass as an evolving magical item because there are so many cool subclasses, especially if you're using like other like third party stuff as well,
mm-hmm.
that can like represent an idea. And they level up nicely. You get these new abilities mm-hmm. unlocking and things. So I just really like to use that as the basis for magic items.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now.
Bye.
You are left alone. The two goblins up at the top of the cenote just run.
Get the fuck out.
Yeah.
Yeah, good idea.
Just wise.
Now you don't get to enjoy their exciting and fun village.
I'm excitedly
prepped.
I'm sorry. didn't
that
feel
was cool as hell.
It was.
Yeah, honestly, a green dragon wouldn't have, right?
That's how I felt about it.
I'm just teasing.
What is it? I think Embra, kind of, as they've gone out with a slightly nervous. But not like Ember style nervous. So there is just not a hesitance, but they step a little softer as they take a step forward and they look over towards Waku. And there's a, Waku, are you in requirement of healing? You look a little, there's a dot green.
With all those that one, it's probably not too much.
I'm okay.
All right.
I'm fine.
Okay.
I feel pretty good. Happy. I feel pretty good as it happens. I feel good.
Well,
that was copyrighted, so we're going to stop there.
Yeah.
If it's a bad enough cover, they can't do shit. If you say it loudly and off key, they can't do anything.
Yeah, parody is covered under fair use, so.
I never take any chances.
I mean that was a laughable rendition, so it must be parody.
It was pretty bad, yeah.
So he's 15 feet up a vine.
Yes.
And he's looking down at what has happened and
he just says echoey kind of woo, yeah.
Yeah. And he'll start beckoning everyone to come back up. Because he's not sure what's going to happen with these quippers.
I'm not going to have the opportunity to do this very much because I've only got all strength for a little bit. So Embra, like, has the weird urge to just sort of flap, and then they and Kai are both fly up much slower. There's a little bit of wobble to the way that the wings move. But when they land, they have, like, a slight amount of, like, I did it kind of, like, face.
I think Waku also with that, you know, with that imbuing of draconic spirit kind of just gives a little experimental flap of the wings, but nothing happens. Yeah.
I feel like your head's getting closer.
Shame.
Okay.
Pretty poison all on you.
There is a weird taste in the back of your throat, though, Waku, because that breath ability is in there now.
Not
does
a fan
it taste
of that.
Like licorice?
No, it
is
tastes
it sarsaparilla?
He was like, well, I was gonna apologize for bringing everybody here and forgetting that part of the story, but everything's coming up aces, so
why would you apologize? This was great.
By the way, see our calculations that, I mean, I guess because not every goblin could attack, you know, only one of them is attacking, it changes it up a bit. But that was a just an insanely deadly encounter, like CR calculation wise.
Really?
20 goblins.
Oh my god.
But I mean, that's, you know, the CR was having them all attack you at the same time. Like, you know, just 20 attacks against you every round as opposed to just a couple, which would have been very different.
Yep.
Okay, so you, clamber up over the, and there's no check needed because of the overgrown foliage and everything spilling down into the cenote, and you clamber back up to the top of the thing there, and carrying on your way towards Kersabal.
We take an hour rest.
Casually. Like that spell slot back. I agree.
I mean, I have a free cast of Animate Undead, but I don't want to have to risk anything. For those that don't know, I need to recast Animate Undead to keep my zombies from turning on me. just for, you know, complete. You recast it once a day?
Top it up.
Yep.
Okay. So, you have a single day's journey. I think you can actually, you actually camp out here. And Hugh.
Yep.
Do you think there's like a situation, or actually do you kind of like hammock it in the canopy?
Although
you did meet those undead monkey things.
I'll be right back.
Oh yeah, no, probably not.
It's still like odds on, it's probably still safer in the canopy than on the ground with all the dinosaurs and everything else.
Oh, I was gonna say, yeah, I think I'd rather deal with an undead monkey than undead Spinosaurus. So,
all right.
Yeah, let's
or a not dead millipede.
Exactly. So you you find a suitable tree in the jungle, off to the edge of the cenote, and you clamber up into it. And you witness something interesting as you're setting up camp. The three of you, you hear like the crunching and tearing of branches and foliage.
Okay.
And you see a large tree that had been like artificially bent over. You see this large tree whip up right again, and there's a spray of leaves and vines that had grown over it as it was bent over. It seems to have been like forced down, and it whips up, and then you see attached to it a very sturdy looking like vine rope, and at the end of this rope is a huge net, and it just trebuchets it over the top and just goes swinging. You just see this massive net. You're hearing all this, Scarlet? Okay. You see this massive net just go sailing over the tree and the canopies, like away from the cenote. And could all three of you give me a perception check? Can you see, Scarlet?
Yeah.
There she is.
Low.
These work are going to be insufferable now. I mean,
Sorry.
Give it an inch, you'll take a mile.
That is a 3.
Mine is also a 3.
That is a natural 20 plus 5.
Thank God. Somebody is not blind.
Ember.
Yeah.
You.
That me.
Hugh and Buck, you just see this massive netted bundle just being catapulted across the jungle.
It's like this.
Yep. And Embra, you can make out what's inside the net, which I should show you on the maps.
nodes. That nice? Oh. Oh?
Sorry, please help. I'm just, Sirenscape's having a little bit of a drop problem here. Just giving it a little chill. Let's just turn off a couple of... turn off a couple of sounds to give it a bit more leeway. Okay. So. yeah, this is no longer something that is able to be visited. If you could all go up to that fog of war in the top left, top right, sorry.
Yep.
And I shall reveal it for you.
Wait, is it the goblin village that just got yeeted? Oh my god, it is! Oh my god, it is!
Yes.
The Batari village, in fear of the reincarnation of Needle, trigger their special escape mechanism. And the, as I may read from the primer here, the mechanism fires and the village relocates.
That is absolutely incredible.
I love how they what didn't say relocates like safely though. That's my favorite part. It's not relocate safely, just relocates.
Yeah, back home. Everyone enjoy that wondrous little
thing there. It's so funny.
We have never properly tested this. We're just gonna see if it works.
They're like, I like how the one goblin that has to trigger the thing is left like outside because it fires. It's just like one little goblin just like, ah!
I love... Yeah, I think
T-Rex.
The, right. Yeah, what is it? It's the exclamation mark above the T-Rex where it's like, ah! For me.
I don't miss the third panel with the question
yeah.
mark.
Yeah.
It's just like, huh? Yeah.
Huh?
How did that happen?
Oh, the T-Rex, yeah.
Yeah.
Hang on, let me remind myself of the mechanics for landing that.
Is there landing ability, or is it just aim?
Please hold. Here we go. okay, this is a last... okay, that makes more sense. mm-hmm. Goblins don't launch themselves in this contraption. It's too deadly. so it's kind of like, it would mess you up if you were still inside. Like, if there are people attack, they all go outside the net and they just fling the attackers away.
Right.
So they relocate their village and then they have to find their village. Then they have to go and find it.
Yeah. Anyone inside the net when the village is launched hits the ground must make a DC 15 dexterity saving throw or take 8d6 bludgeoning.
Whoa.
So even if they were all nat ones, that would kill any goblin inside.
Yeah, right.
Or half on a success. So
as that goes across the air, Embra, like following with a gaze, looks over to the others, like slowly as everyone's kind of woken up in their tree bunk and gone, I believe that may have been a village.
Hugh's gonna look at Embra, look in that direction, kind of like shake his head from fatigue, and like, like whatever.
He rolls back over in the morning. Wait, Embra, did you say that was a village?
The way you thought. I just want
to. Yeah.
They detailed all this damage. Which means they intended for the adventurers to set it off while the goblins were in there.
Probably. Or have the goblins set it off with the adventurers in there, if they're attacked.
Fair.
Either or.
But the queen's hut's in there somewhere. Anyway.
Whoops.
also, you'll notice the large mound of earth, number 5, right next to the pictures there. I'm afraid the one thing you have lost, I wanted to still share this fun thing with you, but the one thing you have lost from not visiting the village is you do not get to learn the wonders of ant husbandry, which is what these goblins are specializing
in. I'm sorry? There are ant husbandry?
There are three giant anthills around the village, connected by tunnels underneath the village, quote unquote.
Sure.
Which I think I was trying to think why, because it doesn't say why what they do that for. So my idea is that they're, you know, those ants that have the bulbous kind of like sweet syrup.
Oh yeah.
So I think they harvest that potentially.
Okay.
And so, there's some types of ants that like you can just straight up eat.
Honeypot ants. Those ones.
Cool.
So that one question?
Yeah, just protein.
Protein.
Safer than hunting dinosaurs.
Yeah, just a touch.
Okay, so yes, the village of Yelliark is elsewhere.
Yelliark.
Bye.
Happy landings. Okay.
And Burby closes their eyes softly.
And you take a long rest.
Thank you, spell slots.
Now, where's my
long rest?
Okay, we have. Let's go back to the Cholson map. We have one last day to journey across to Kersabal. Had anyone not made a roll for an encounter? I forget.
I think we all managed two last time.
I think we all made one. And we all made two last time.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's true, yeah, because it was a long trek from the bay, wasn't it?
Yep.
Okay, so, that one last hexagon between you and the village, the monastery. So, to think how boldly I was tweeting about the session going live with the images of the monastery, like, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, right.
We do have Dan Karn coming up soon. Dan Karn supplements coming up soon as well, which will delve into the Nisi wastes there a little more. We will get to do giveaways with that. And to message Dan, he's like, not going to be today. We'll keep
in our defense, there was battle stacks. Like, battle stacks are pretty important. Slingable villages also pretty important.
Exactly. I want you to get the full Chilton experience. A difference. Wilderness encounters. Beach, no. Jungle, no undead. Yes. You're still outside the... Despite being so close to the Nisi Wastes, this is not a treacherous undead zone.
Oh, we'll be getting there. Don't worry.
We're working
on it.
Well,
you're going to fly over it, hopefully.
I want to get a good look at it. Let's put it that way.
What is it? It's just like, to your left, you will see... undead hordes of unfathomable terror, amongst other things. Oh, and look, a volcano.
You, leading the expedition. Clover. Hey, goodnight, McClover. Oh, it's me. Leading the expedition, McClover there. Not McClover. He's leading the expedition to bed. Hugh, leading the last day's journey. Please roll me a
d20. Certainly. D20. A 2, John.
Okay, remember it was high was encounter, so you...
High was bad,
A peaceful, lovely remaining journey through the jungle, looking at the various plants. I think Ember is fascinated, you know, relearning everything.
Yeah.
And coming across all these new things. You get to experience it all again.
Yes, there's a lot of, like, looks over this, that looks poisonous, checks over to Waku. See if Waku's physically reacting. Okay, it should be fine. Continue going on. Like, do we understand inherently that Waku's nature has changed?
I don't think anything visible, no.
Okay. Then I suppose that Ember isn't exactly interviewing.
Let's drop back into the canopy of the night before. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say that. I pictured it on the walk back, mainly because the battle stacks was sort of confusing. And I think that at one point Ember's like, "So if I stand on your shoulders, is that how it works? Was there more power in that stack? If we all stand on Hugh's shoulders, Like, did you control the dragon from within there? I know you do stuff with undead and skulls. It's just gesturing with small tiny things. Being like,
a lot of questions. I'm a bit confused about the direction of your inquiry.
I am too.
So the battle stacks were cool and all, right? But
right.
Did you see the part where I blew up two entire stacks at the same time?
I did.
Maybe it wasn't a good idea.
But it wasn't the same color as usual. Usually it's dark and screamy and covered in skulls.
It was totally dark and screamy and covered in skulls and green.
It was green, yes. Is green new?
What?
Is the green new for you?
I mean, kinda. It's a little new.
Again, slowly side-eyeing you, being like, this is okay, right? I don't know what's going on. This is what people do, yes? They just turn into green.
I, the great and powerful Waku, sometimes acquire new and magnificent powers.
Understandable.
Like green. Learn,
like green. The power of green.
Harness the power of green.
You with closed eyes is like, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And as Ember is just also nodding along. So again, do I stand on Hugh's shoulders and we stand on your great and powerful shoulders?
Doesn't sound like a good idea.
I think a certain amount of training goes into battle stack tactics.
Stack tactics, yes.
Stack tactics.
that's the also, conversation for that peaceful journey.
Waku, I think as you say, I have harnessed the power of green. You like outstretch your hand. Roll me a d20. On a nat 20, there's a timely gust of wind.
Come on.
No.
I just yes.
John, we'll thaumaturgy.
The what is it? The yes, the leaves are green.
And
that dragonfly.
I know, right? It's
just like hi.
Okay. As you reach towards the end of the day, and the sky is starting to turn. The peaches and creams of a sunset disappearing far over the jungle to the west. There is a break in the canopy from time to time, and you start to see glimpses of a massive plateau jutting high above the jungle. Rocky outcrops and little clumps of green clinging to the cliffs as it rises up above the jungle you're passing through. Having heard what you'd heard about the Arakokra Monastery, you correctly assume this is the right place, and heading towards it, you eventually get to a point where the jungle breaks against the rising rock like a perpetuous green wave. And as you emerge, you crane your necks, looking up high above, and you see an ancient monastery overlooking the jungle from its perch on the cliff of the tall plateau. Stone steps and rickety walkways connect various buildings, the lowest of which is 500 feet above the ground. The largest main-looking building has a intricate, circular, maze-like symbol carved into its crumbling facade. A symbol Hugh knows all too well as being that of Ubtau. Every few minutes, you see Arakokra birdfolk, either landing at the monastery or launching themselves from its balconies to take to the sky. You have arrived at Kersaval.
That is a rather large rock.
Well, some of us can just flap our wings and fly up there, I guess.
But perhaps we should knock, or equivalent.
On the rock? Is that,
well,
that word?
There's treacherous, large battle stacks and dinosaurs and stuff. I don't know if they'll be necessarily kind on first glance.
Hugh thinks, he wonders to himself if it would be rude to fly as a non Arakocra in at an Arakocra monastery. Like, it's
We traveled for one day, John. But sorry, but
yes.
I put away my dice. I need a roll for the number of fears I get back.
Okay, so
one.
You correctly assume, Ember, yes, that just flying up to immediately, although just from the way this place is positioned, like either flying or climbing up the walkways, you're going to be clocked and noticed before you arrive, so that they'll see that you're not goblins or anything. Now let's have a look here. Yes, Ember, thanks to the generosity of chat and the luck of the spin of the wheel there, I'm going to say you do not need to make these checks that are about to be partaken in by Waku and Hugh.
Because I will working back up and making sure people don't die.
Yes, absolutely. Actually, there's one I'm going to have you make.
Okay.
As we've said before, for Waku and Ember, with the glide ability and that fly ability, it doesn't actually going to affect you in any way. But...
Mm.
Yes, Ember.
I was just going to say, I would like to summon Kai, but Kai emits the wild magic sword, yes?
Yes. It was 8 hours, wasn't it?
Said for the next 8 hours, yeah.
8 hours,
it's
okay.
It's been a long rest, so you're okay.
Okay, in that case, I'd like to bring out Kai when we start the journey up, mainly because in a worst case scenario, if we do see someone falling, Kai can, like, do the... I mean, it's fiery, but they can technically catch you and bring you back up to that teleported spot with their ability. But we will have several explosions along the way.
Yes. that
as
could,
a backup
could
for you.
Affect your the welcome you receive.
Apologies.
Okay. You start to make the climb, you can see, you know, originally the monastery structures could be reached by an ascending path of combined natural stone ramps, steps cut into the cliff face, and wooden walkways built onto the cliff. The ramps and steps are still mostly intact, but the wooden walkways are rotting or missing entirely in many places, as the monks, you know, the Arakocra don't need them and have no reason to repair them. First, as you start to clamber up towards the buildings, I need Waku and Hugh to make an athletics check to climb around some missing walkways.
Okay.
You know, I'm not good at that.
I know.
Who?
Two?
Can Waku, like, just attach himself to me? Like...
No, sorry.
No? Okay. Okay.
If I fall, like, I'll just glide down.
I have a +8 to athletics right now.
Nice.
I want to... Well, not right now. because it's strength based.
Yep, yep.
And I rolled a nat one.
Oh no.
So, yeah.
Okay.
Thankfully, it was the first one, I guess, and not the last one.
Well, regardless of how high up you are, you hit other pieces of the walkway. So, this is as written in the module. You have a choice to make here, Hugh.
Okay.
Each time a check fails, the character must choose between either taking bludgeoning damage from the fall or a level of exhaustion.
I'm going to take the damage.
Minus one from the next roll.
Yeah, no. I'm going to take the damage this
time. Damage? Okay, yep. So Hugh, trying to climb, as you start to climb around this missing walkway, there are just a piece of the stone just breaks off from the bulk of the tiddy window. And you just go sliding out of view. Ember's like, no, but you do hit another ledge lower down, and you take 11 bludgeoning damage.
Oh, okay.
Oof.
Waku, you can't take the bludgeoning damage, but I'll say having to repeat the climb several times gives you the exhaustion.
Okay.
So you have minus one to next rolls.
Oh no!
Okay.
I hate
Next, clambering past this little spot here is Ember's like, whoosh, 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 come on.
I don't know if it's come on, but I think it's more like, it's very nervous. It's like it is the definition of a hovering presence.
Absolutely. Okay, so moving on, you get to a next section of wooden walkway, and unfortunately, wide gaps have rotted away, and there are just the sturdy support beams left, which are unevenly placed and need a certain amount of skill to leap across. So, Waku and Hugh, please make me an acrobatics check.
Acrobatics.
Slightly better at that.
Okay.
It's a natural
20. Nice. Cartwheeling across.
I got a 10.
Oh dear. Hugh, your wilderness guide. would you like a level of exhaustion or a bludgeoning damage?
Give me the damage.
Okay. I think this doesn't happen as you hit lower down. This, like, you just slip on the beam that you misjudge and just, like, slam your chin against it. It's like...
That's what I have in my head, yeah.
That is going to be 13 bludgeoning damage.
Ouch. Okay.
I'd like to send out the next time they're slipping, like, a soft spirit of, like, an attempt to, like, boost them, but it's not boosting them. I'm just using healing light.
Yes.
Of, like, giving them some extra assistance.
Phantom.
I'm not taking the exhaustion.
Phantom coming in chat here with a reminder of the crystal here. in your trying time.
Yeah.
You have
four?
Plus four to your
HP. Nice.
Bless you.
Also, Phantom giveth and Phantom taketh away, because just before they did suggest that nat one meant you got the exhaustion and the damage.
I saw that. Thank you, Phantom. Nat one.
Last but not least, a check that you all get to make here, as there is a section of wooden walkway, like the last kind of leading up. Actually, sorry, what am I doing here? To Cursabal. The fog of war areas are the interior of buildings, which you haven't seen yet.
Ah, lovely.
So here we are. Clambering up.
Cursabal.
So you get to those last pieces of walkway there, and you're climbing around or jumping over those missing pieces. But Embra, you're not used to flying all the time, so like just permanently flying is a bit tough. So you're walking where there's a stretch of walkway there. I'd like all of you to make a perception check.
God!
Waku with minus one.
That's not great for me.
I'm using my crystal.
You use the crystal?
23.
I'm using the crystal.
A 23 from me.
Gotcha.
Plus 4.
An 11!
Okay.
Plus a d4.
Ooh, Phantom's okay.
So, 13. 17!
Okay. Oh, Phantom and Hugh sharing a 17 there. Okay. Ember and Hugh notice the rotted planking that won't support the weight it looks like it should. And skip over it and turn. Waku, watch! And the planking just gives way as Waku's like confidently striding. I am a dragon. I am a dragon.
Falling!
And you take another level of exhaustion.
How about we say that the plank gives way, and instead of falling, he slams his head into the plank in front of him as
pivots up.
No, I imagine like he's walking, right? So like you're walking, yeah. And like this board gives way, and yes. Like he's
pitches forward.
Just pitches, and you pitch forward into the remaining planks and slam your head. I'd rather take the damage this time.
Okay. That is 14 bludgeoning damage. Someone doesn't want minus 2 from any social checks.
I don't. it's more that it takes a while to recover.
Yeah, that would take a couple of days, wouldn't it? Yeah, that's true. Okay. So, you managed to clamber up the last part of the planking there. The wind whipping around you. And switch over here. You see at the threshold of that lower clutch of buildings there a tall, thoughtful looking Arakocra. Kind of eagle-like plumage, kind of browns and things in the feathers there. The kind of eagle. Hey, Phantom, thank you for that crystal back for Hugh. Coming in clutch with the dream prize today. And you see the Arakocra. And they turn. As you see that they're sweeping the planking outside there. You see that the planking here is reasonably maintained. Now, there's a couple of patches where it's still a bit dodgy. but they turn to you and stop the cleaning that they were doing. And as you look up, you do see other Arakocra about other tasks.
Oh, no. Ember has been taught that waving is what you do, mm-hmm. And it's just, like, very tiny talons being, like...
Jonathan!
Jonathan!
Is this where he retired after being humiliated up in Icewind Dale in the movie? I just realized to myself, when I was so sad for the movie, imagine how successful the movie would have been if it had come out after Baldur's Gate 3 instead.
I know.
Mm. And just like the success of the game would have just
boosted
it so much.
It would have guaranteed a sequel.
Yep.
I think it didn't lose money, so it's
right,
still...
Right,
yeah.
It just wasn't what they were hoping for.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's so weird, because like all the reviews were great. Mm-hmm. Like even, and like, everyone, you know, even people that don't play, like, all loved it. Just didn't mm-hmm. get the traction. They didn't promote it.
Also, it was kind of roughly around the time of all the OGL drama as well.
True. Yeah, a lot of people did say they were going to boycott. That's true, yeah.
Yeah, there was also the boycott, and there was also, the fact that they had in the opening title Hasbro's Dungeons & Dragons. Like, that was
Thanks,
a smart
Hasbro.
Move at the time. And I was like, that was a bad idea. You could... That was so
totally,
bad.
Totally. Fair enough. So, yeah, you see the various Arakokra monks here going about their tasks, you know, sweeping, cleaning. It does seem like a fairly kind of ritualized kind of lifestyle here. Just people all chipping in. And you can, as you can hear in Sanskrit there are prayer flags catching the updrafts from the breeze, which kind of look like almost pyramidal as they're kind of like being blown straight up by the updrafts from the cliff. And you see the monks. Hey raiders, welcome in. How you doing?
Hello.
You see a few Arakokra actually taking advantage of that when they're going up to higher levels. They just step out and catch an updraft and go whoop up instead of doing the zigzag walk all the way up, or you know, having to, you know, the exertion of actually flying up. You can see two layers of houses. I like how it's got that kind of, you know, those old First Nations settlements that are built into the side of canyons, like, you know, those old, like in the shelves in canyons. And
oh, yes.
Right? You see how that second layer's got that kind of style of building? As well as, like,
totally picturing this at the air temples from Avatar as well. Eastern?
I only have the live action to go by, but yes, yeah. Beautiful. And you can see that larger building that you can't see the maze from this viewpoint. It's only visible from the jungle floor, or if you're flying. but you do see that large main building up above, and a couple of more ornate buildings above that, which, you know, just by the general kind of feel of things, you'd assume that's where the head priest and stuff would be. And there seems to be another building there. And if you go up to there, if you see, you see that just above where there's that kind of little cave across from the main hall, you do actually see, like, in the topmost, like, head priest looking quarters, there is a big hole in the bottom, which would be visible from where you are. again, not too much concern for an Arakokra.
Yeah.
And the Arakokra turns and says, "Well traveled, and welcome to our humbled yet lofty abode. You must be tired. Please, come. You should rest. And meet Ashara."
"I am, in fact, tired."
"Please. Thank you so much.
You are welcome here." "Please, follow me."
Out of character.
Oh, no.
Out of character flashback.
Oh, no.
Sorry, I didn't click immediately. There were cultists.
"Be welcome."
Oh, there were cultists in Descent and Drovenus, so there was a whole "be welcome" thing.
I see.
I'm still going to play one of those cultists one day.
Absolutely. okay, so we shall stop there as you arrive at the monastery. And thank you. Yeah, we get to meet. And if our new character that's joining the party is going to be coming in next week, all things going well. Are they here? Somewhere in the temple? We shall have to wait and see. So, massive thank you to everyone. Absolutely pleasure to have you all in with us, and not least to these fine three players here dealing with the battle sex in a glorious fashion. So, heading over to that far corner, Hugh, where can people find you on the material for you?
"Hello, everybody. I am Colby. I have been Hugh the Echo Knight Fighter. On the material plane, I am one half of Vexed Vending, a creative vending machine group here in Central Florida. We use vending machines to help small creators, makers, and artists reach our massive swaths of tourists here in Central Florida without having to babysit a booth or pay expensive booth and artist alley fees at conventions. So we are on Instagram. Do check us out. If you're interested in having your stuff featured, please definitely give us a shout. We have two machines currently active. Out in the Orlando area. So awesome. Thank you very much, John."
"Thank you. Ember, yourself."
Hi everyone, I'm Scarlet Song, she, her, you're not a Lycan librarian. When I am not on Phoenix Owaki, you can usually find me over on the channel that is currently taking break, mine, but because I am inundated with work that I am catching up on. I haven't been sketching out comms right now. But also you'll find me over on the College of Inspiration bi-weekly for ArcPoint. In terms of news and things to announce, the first audio version of the bi-weekly newsletter that I've been doing has been released over on Spotify, awesome. The bi-weekly Bardic Inspiration. I mentioned the Crit Awards. We were talking about a cool Zelda RPG we featured, Quest Junkies UK. Yeah, so if you have a chance, go check it out. It'll be somewhere in self-promo in the Discord.
Nice.
Thank you.
Thank you. And what?
Hi, my name is Josh. I am a simulacrum created for the sole purpose of playing Dungeons & Dragons and other role-playing games. You cannot find me outside of this channel when I am not in front of your screen. I am locked in John's basement, being forced to write new wild magic tables for him to enjoy.
Not true.
So please come back. I don't particularly enjoy writing wild magic tables. So
that's a lie.
Please come back.
Thank you, Annie. Thank you, Annie. And we are Phoenix Awaki, we wrote some TTRPGs, and we will be back to continue this little birthday week of mine. And
Tunix,
I'm watching it. Because I wanted to, you can see. Anyway,
Do you count each individual eye as one blink?
Yes, Phantom, in a closet under the stairs. That's when an owl visited one day. He's like, "You're a necromancer, Waku."
That's just true.
I went off to the. Is Candlekeep the Forgotten Realms Hogwarts?
I don't know. It's that.
Strixhaven, isn't it?
Yeah.
There you go. Nice.
But Strixhaven's also in Magic the Gathering, so...
True. Thank you, everyone. Yes, and if you want to head on over to the Discord, jump in there and get news about what's going on with us, including our upcoming birthday of the channel, the anniversary new campaign, Humblewood, maybe starting in a couple of months. And I'm looking forward to that. But until next time, as we continue on the birthday week, with what's going to be next, Candlekeep Mysteries at the start of the weekend, and Phandelverum below, and then rounding out the weekend with these folks at Cresabar. So, looking forward to all of that goodness. And if you want to see the VODs, thank you, Phantom. You can jump in there, see all our previous sessions, most of our previous sessions, and the majority are up there. And we shall look forward to catching you next time. Thanks for all the bits and everything today. Absolute pleasure, as always. I'm saving that spin for Matty and Scarlet, so that we can jump in next time. But do stick around, friends. Let's head off raiding. Who's up?
Mm-hmm.
So that. Scarlet's on, Creeps on.
Ink and Lyre is on.
Yeah.
Architects of Fate.
Well,
also people. Playing Tomb of Annihilation.
Let's see here. Let's go over to Chaotic and Writer. I think here. Because we did Ink and Lyre recently. Let's head over to Chaotic and Writer here. Doing some tavern talk. So let's go and see what that's all about. Thanks everybody, as always, stick around for that raid. If you've got them, those phoenixes fly. And until next time, as we sit around these months, always in the same.
Peace
to me. Thank you.